Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and a very, very warm welcome to all of you to the Cobham Theatre and to the annual Fourth Form House Drama Competition. It is an absolute triumph that the houses that are performing today have managed that. Almost every obstacle has been put in their way. Well, they only had 3 weeks to prepare, but the dreaded C that we don't mention has actually paid to a couple of houses, and we send our commiserations to Littleton and Lupton, who were here on Tuesday. They teched their pieces, they had costume, and they had learnt some of their lines, and they're very sorry not to be with us tonight, and maybe there'll be an opportunity in the future for them to perform. But there has been extraordinary ingenuity in the remaining 9 houses to ensure that they still keep going, which means that you might well see a couple of performers tonight that aren't in the fourth form. I haven't identified them on the programme, but you might be able to work out who they are. Many of these performers have never been on stage before, ever. Certainly, I think almost every single one of them has not been in front of a live audience for at least 2 years. And so they're going to do a fantastic job. They're raring to go, and we can't wait to see what they're going to do. All the pieces tonight have been directed by students or by their sixth form mentors, and they're really cracking. They're very, very good. I just want to say that we should find ourselves in the bar at 8:05, and then take your time, because our wonderful and esteemed adjudicator, Ms. Jill Bradford, who's head of drama here, we'll need some time to work out the winners. I can't tell who is going to win, so I'm very, very grateful indeed to her. So take your time, and then eventually you'll be ushered back for the adjudication and the presentations that will be made at the end of the evening. I think that's everything I was supposed to say. I'm just very, very proud of all the students, and you should be as well. I know you will be. Have a great evening, and we'll see you again.
Detention is about suffering.
It is about renewal and a second chance.
It is about discipline.
Hope.
Agony.
Change.
Yeah, a change of shorts, because I'll scare the unit what out of you.
Oh, you are so funny. Isn't it funny, children? You will be missed.
I doubt it. See you around, Gertrude. They're all yours.
You can call me Gertie. I have an amazing growth opportunity for all of you. Instead of your usual detention, we will be performing in a play.
Oh.
One of the challenges for school drama is finding a large enough cast to do some of the plays we'd like to do. So, all of you will be taking part in my next production. If you successfully complete this production, you will be released from detention. But who knows, some of you may get bit by the theatre bug.
Oh,
Well, if it wasn't from the Reign of the Dead.
No, it's not.
Just like a couple of my star performers, there is Penny Hepburn, of course, one of your fellow students here. And last but not least, the future star of stage and screen, Bella Gable! Thank you, everyone. I am here to guide you not only on this stage, but on this actor's journey to the soul. Drama is everything to me. As an actor, I want to make my mark. In this school, they worship the quarterback and collect lots of sports trophies. I want to change all that. I want to change all that. I want to give this school lots of drama trophies. I want to win Best Actor at the State Drama Competition. I want to stand in front of you and proudly say that I am the best in show.
That's for sure.
This is so exciting! The play we're going to do is a 1920s tale of murder and mystery. Yes. It was a time of flappers, prohibition, and gangsters. I thought this might be good since some of you kids in detention might be from gangs. Do we have any real gang members among you that could help make this more authentic for us?
So you want us to be from one of them gangs that kills people, or just that steals stuff?
Well, I'm not sure. We'll figure that out as we go.
So, why should we do this for you? We're in detention already. How are you going to make it worse?
Some of you are the worst detention offenders, but I promise you time off for your good behaviour. Doing well in my production means an early ticket out of detention.
Is there a musical? Need any singers? I can sing. 99 balls appear on the wall, 99 balls appear. Table down, pass it around. 98 balls appear on the wall, 99 balls appear on the wall.
Right, moving on. Are there any questions about this play?
Yeah, is there any, kissing?
Yes, there will be some kissing. Ben and I are going to step out a moment to discuss some of the casting. Please remain in your assigned spots. We'll be close by, so no funny business.
So it's bad, Penny. Always turning up. Why are you here, drama queen?
I did nothing. I'm innocent.
I heard you did something pretty bad. You stole from the principal. You broke into his office and took something. What was it?
The crown jewels. Or the Hope Diamond. I steal so much I lose track.
Starting to like you, drama queen.
Too bad.
Come on, Penny. What was it?
It was helping out a friend. Now drop it, okay? Leave her alone, Bender.
Isn't our head cheerleader here to cheer us up during detention? I always thought it was a little weird a guy wanted to be a cheerleader. I mean, maybe a mascot, so you could hide your face. Although, our mascot is the woodchuck, so that wouldn't be too cool. Why are you here, cheer boy?
I beat someone up. I punched his face in. I got tired of him saying things about me that just weren't true.
I bet we all know what he was saying, cheer boy. We all think it, but he was the only one stupid enough to say it.
Well, I'm not.
Well, we all say things about you.
What's the matter? Don't want to be my girlfriend anymore?
I never was, loser.
That hurts. I thought we had something.
Touch me again and die.
Just one little kiss.
Leave her alone.
You say something?
Yeah. Leave her alone.
Make me. And get off! Guys, get off!
Thank you. Miss Sophie, a poor, frail old woman, unable to see the cutlery in front of her, must host a party of guests who unfortunately have all passed away. How will the butler, James, make this a night to remember?
Good evening, Miss Sophie. Good evening.
Good evening, James.
You're looking very well this evening, Miss Sophie.
Well, I'm feeling very better. Thank you, James.
Good, good.
Why? Everything looks nice.
Thank you very much, Miss Sophie.
Is everybody here?
All here for your anniversary, Miss Sophie.
All five places are laid out?
All laid out as usual.
Sir Toby?
Sir Toby, he's sitting here, Miss Sophie.
And Wolf von Schneider?
Admiral von Schneider's sitting here.
Mr. Pomeroy?
Mr. Pomeroy is sitting here.
And my very dear friend, Mr. Winterbottom.
On your left, as you requested.
Thank you, James. Now you may serve the soup.
The soup? They're all waiting for you, Miss Sophie. Would you care for a drop of mulligatawny soup?
I'm particularly fond of mulligatawny soup, James.
I know you are.
I think of the sherry with the soup.
Sherry with the soup? By the way, same procedure as last year, Miss Sophie.
The same procedure as every year, James. Sir Toby?
Cheerio, Miss Sophie.
Admiral von Schneider.
Must I say it's this year, Miss Sophie?
Just to please me, James.
Just to please you. Yeah, yeah, skål!
Mr. Pomeroy.
Happy New Year, Miss Sophie.
And dear Mr. Winterbottom.
Well, here we are again, more lovely.
You may now serve the fish.
The fish? Did you enjoy the soup, Miss Sophie?
Delicious,
The chicken.
That looks like a fine bird.
A very fine bird, Miss Sophie.
I think we'll have champagne for bird.
Champagne with the birds. Same procedure as last year, Miss Sophie.
The same procedure as every year, James. Sir Toby.
Cheerio, Miss Sophie.
Admiral von Schneider.
Must I say it? Skål!
Mr. Pomeroy.
Happy New Year, Megan.
Mr. Winterbottom.
You're looking even younger.
Please serve the fish.
The fish? Would you care for some North Sea haddock, Miss Sophie?
I think of a white wine with the fish.
White wine with the fish? Same procedure as last year, Miss Sophie.
The same procedure as every year, James. Sir Toby?
Cheerio, Miss Sophie!
Admiral von Schneider.
Skål!
Mr. Pomeroy.
Happy New Year! Yeah.
And Mr. Winterbottom.
You're one of the nicest women I've ever seen, Miss Sophie.
Mm-hmm.
I now declare this bazaar open. So forth. Would you care for some fish, Miss Sophie?
I think we'll have port with the fruit.
Port with the fruit, our fruit. Here you go, Miss Sophie. Port with the fruit, did you say? Same procedures last year.
The same procedures every year, James. Sir Toby.
Cheerio, Miss Sophie.
Admiral von Schneider.
Skull!
Mr. Pomeroy.
Happy New Year, Miss Sophie.
Mr. Winterbottom.
I love you, Miss.
Well, James, it's been a wonderful party.
I've enjoyed it very much.
I think I'll retire.
You're going to bed. Let me help you.
As I said, I think I'll retire.
Same procedures last year.
The same procedures every year,
Dave. I'll try my very best.
Doing cereals.
But they put that bloody student on it. Makes me sick.
It's not fair, is it?
I mean, she's only here for the holidays. I don't like her.
No, I don't.
I wouldn't care, but I was loading bloody freezers all day yesterday. My hands nearly dropped off. It was that cold.
They should give you gloves, you know. You're not supposed to do it without gloves.
I know.
But they don't care.
No.
I'm looking forward to Mandy's party tomorrow night.
God and me. Can't believe she's 21, you know.
Well, you're not so far off.
I know, but it seems so old.
Here, though.
I'll tell you something. I might leave this job. I might do that hairdressing course at the tech that our Sandra's doing. She says it's great.
But you wouldn't make much money, though, would you?
I know, but I've always fancied hairdressing. It'd be better than this.
I suppose so.
Our Sandra's doing my hair when we're going out.
Oh, yes.
Crimping it.
Oh.
What you're wearing?
The black dress again, I suppose.
Nice, that.
It's all right.
Shaz and Tracy getting all new stuff, aren't they?
Well, they must have more money than me, then.
I might nip out to Topshop in my dinner out. It's Pusher's Shakers. I need to get something smart.
Yes.
Now that's something I wouldn't mind.
What?
Working in a cocktail bar.
One happy hour from 6 till 7. One brace of TV producers. One very tired cocktail waitress, thank you.
Oggy, oggy, oggy!
Oi, oi, oi!
Alright, missus.
Okay, what do you have?
What would you like, sir?
Too early for any of that, thanks.
Sorry?
Never mind. I'll have a...
You wait for hours until the silly oaf has decided what he wants. First he'll choose a lager.
I'll have a lager.
Then he'll change his mind because of the blood pressure.
No, no, must think about the old blood pressure.
And you nod, like you're concerned.
I think I'll have a...
He'll go for a martini.
Martini.
I knew it. With lemonade and ice.
With...
Lemonade and ice, sir.
How marvellous.
So it's served. And then he says to his mates he's got a double measure.
I've got a double measure.
Yeah. That's a happy hour, sir. 6 till 7, double measure for the price of one.
What's everyone else having? Jerry?
Mervyn?
Jerry?
Mervyn?
What are you having?
What's your poison?
They've just been looking at the new car outside.
We've just been looking at a new car.
What are you having?
Martini!
I'm me, Willie.
Three martinis, lovey.
Vitamins and a smile, lovey.
Wonderful.
Didn't touch the sides.
Lovely motor out there.
Same again. Jerry,
Mervyn.
Oh, I don't know.
I have a long drive.
What the hell?
Same again.
And before they can utter the order, whoosh, three martinis.
With lemonade?
Yes, sir.
Gosh, what a day.
Really?
Hasn't it just?
We're working in Studio One.
It's such a bloody effort.
Who's directing?
Brian.
Oh, God.
What a prick. Honestly, it takes a man forever to do a 2-minute scene.
He likes to feel that he's been taken seriously. He's straight out of Oxford and straight into the Beeb.
Aren't they all?
The script's a dream.
They're talking louder now. The name dropping follows shortly.
Aren't you two working on the new Bluesdale project?
Yeah, that's right. I'm producing, Jerry's assistant.
And Brian's directing that.
I think that's what he calls it.
It's an excellent car.
Isn't,
another Willy?
Please.
Three more, please, lovey.
Oh, no ice in mine. It goes right through me.
Julie Walters.
Oh, yeah, she's marvellous.
Oh, she's wonderful, isn't it? Julie Walters.
Excuse me, did you say Julie Walters?
Oh, she's marvellous, isn't it?
Camera likes her.
Oh, absolutely.
Which is more than can be said for the other one.
How's the Volvo?
Changed it.
Really?
Got myself a new Sierra 4XR.
How did you find it?
Well, I just opened the garage and there it is!
Oh, brilliant. Another, everyone?
Same again, lovey. How's Vicky?
Oh, God.
What's the matter?
Vicky. Hell, must ring the old girl. Shan't be a mo. Hello, Vicky, darling. It's Will. Listen, lovey. Sorry to be such an awful drag.
But something's cropped up. No, lovey, still at the studio.
Studio?
We're having a bit of a scene war and the scriptwriter's is having a bit of a fit. It might take forever. No, of course I'm not in a bar, darling.
What's the first thing you remember?
The first thing that comes into my head, you mean?
No. What's the first thing you remember?
Ah. No. It's no good. It was a long time ago, I forgot.
You don't get my meaning. What's the first thing you remember after all the things that you have forgotten?
Oh, I see. I've forgotten the question.
What's the first thing that happened this morning?
I woke up, I suppose. Oh, I've got it now. That man, a foreigner, he woke us up.
A messenger! That's it! Pale sky before dawn, a man standing on the saddle to bang on the shoulder shouts, "What's all the row about? Clear off!" And then he called our names. You remember that? This man woke us up.
Yes.
We were sent for.
Yes.
That's why we're here. Traveling.
Then where are we going?
Forward.
I say!
Yes?
I can hear. I thought I heard music.
Yes?
Like a band! It sounded like a band. Drums.
Yes.
It couldn't have been real. I knew all along it was a band!
In your arms was a band!
Here they come!
Oh, an audience! Don't move!
Perfect! A lucky thing we came along!
Why's that?
Why we go rusty? And you catch us at the very corner, taking it! By this time tomorrow, we might have forgotten everything we ever knew!
That's a thought, isn't it?
Ha 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 ha! We'd be back where we started, improvising.
Tumblers, are you?
We can give you a tumble if that's your taste. And times being what they are. Otherwise, for a jingle of coin, you do a selection. Gory romance.
Ha!
We'll find cadence and corpses, practice from the Italian.
And it doesn't take too much to make a jingle. Even a single coin has music in it. Tragedians at your command.
Well, my name is Guildenstern, and this is Rosencrantz. I'm sorry. His name is Guildenstern, and I'm Rosencrantz.
A pleasure. We've played to bigger, of course. But quality counts for something.
I recognise you at once.
And who are we?
As fellow artists.
I thought we were gentlemen.
For some of us, it's performance. For others, patronage.
They are two sides of the same coin. Or, shall I say, since as there are so many of us, the same side of two coins.
What is your line?
Tragedy, sir. That's in disclosure.
Universal, particular.
Denouement, both unexpected and inexorable.
Transvestite melodrama on all levels, including the suggestive.
Ooh.
We transport you into the world of intrigue and illusion. Clowns, if you like.
Murders.
Indeed. Yes.
Scrambish levels.
Heroes!
Ha!
Villains! Tall men lovers! Set peace! And the poetic name.
But granted, this is a coin of price! But that comes under realism, which there are special terms. Getting more than that.
Well, I don't know.
It costs a little to watch. And a little more if you happen to get caught up in the action, if you actually taste it. How do you think what they are?
What are they?
Indifferent.
Bad.
Wicked. Now, what precisely is your pleasure? Gentlemen, disport yourselves! There, see anything you like?
What do they do?
Let your imagination run riot! They are beyond surprise!
And how much?
To take part?
To watch.
Watch what?
A private performance.
How private?
Well, it's only the two of us, is that enough?
For an audience, disappointing. But voyeurs, about average.
What's the difference?
10 guilders?
10 guilders?!
I mean, 8?
Together?
For each. I don't think you understand.
What are you saying?
What am I saying? 7!
Where have you been?
Roundabout. A group of children carries the custom of our town. Juvenile companies. They are the fashion. But they cannot match your repertoire. We'll still do anything unless you're bent.
They grow up.
There's one being born every minute. Onwards!
Where are you going?
Home! Home, sir.
Where from?
Home. We're traveling people. We have no control over where we're going. Tonight we play to the court. Or the night after. Or to the tavern. Or not.
And perhaps I could use my influence?
At the tavern?
At the court. I would say I have some influence.
Would you say so?
I have influence yet.
Yet what?
I have influence! You know, I recall you saying something about, getting caught up in the action.
Ooh, I did! You're quicker than your friend. Now, for a handful of guilders, I happen to have a private and uncut performance of the rape of the Sabine woman! Ooh. Or rather, woman. Rather, Alfred. And for anyone to participate, take either part or both for 10 with encores!
Really is. We don't belong to anyone.
Oh, I am so very, very glad to hear you say so. But do you really think legislation will improve matters in any way, dear? I'm told that nowadays all the married men live like bachelors, and all the bachelors live like married men.
I certainly never know one from the other.
Oh, I think one could always know at once whether a man has home claims upon his life or not. I've noticed a very, very sad expression in the eyes of so many married men.
All that I've noticed is that men are horribly tedious when they are good husbands, and abominably conceited when they are not.
Well, I suppose the type of husband has completely changed into my own days. But I'm bound to state that poor dear Hans Stanton was the most delightful of creatures and was as good as gold.
Ah, my husband is sort of a promissory note. I'm tired of meeting him.
But you renew him from time to time, don't you?
Oh, no, Lady Caroline. I have only had one husband as yet. I suppose you think upon me as sort of an amateur.
With your views on life, I wonder you married at all.
So do I.
My dear.
My dear child, I believe you're really very happy in your married life, but that you like to hide your happiness from others.
I assure you, I was horribly deceived in earnest.
Oh, I hope not, dear. I knew his mother quite well. She was a Stratton, Caroline, one of Lord Cronin's daughters.
Victoria Stratton? I remember her perfectly. A silly, fair-haired woman with no chin.
Ah, Ernest has a chin. A very strong chin. A square chin. Ernest's chin is far too square.
But do you really think a man's chin can be too square? I think a man should be very, very strong. That's a chin to be quite, quite square.
Well, then you should certainly know Ernest, Lady Stutfield. It is only fair to tell you beforehand that he has got no conversation at all.
I adore silent.
Oh, Ernest isn't silent. He talks the whole time, but he's got no conversation. What he talks about, I don't know. I haven't listened to him for years.
Have you never forgiven him, then? How sad that seems. But all life is very, very sad, is it not?
Life, Lady Stutfield, is simply a mauvais quart d'heure, made up of exquisite moments.
Yes, there are moments, certainly. But was it something very, very wrong that Mr. Allenby
did? Did he become angry with you and say that it was unkind or cruel?
Well, I will tell you if you solemnly promise to tell everybody else.
Thank you.
I will make a point of repeating it.
Well, when Ernest and I were engaged, he swore to me positively, on his knees, that he had never loved anyone before in the whole course of his life. I was very young at the time, so I didn't believe him. I needn't tell you. However, I made no inquiries until we were married 4 or 5 months. I found out then that what he had told me was perfectly true. And that sort of thing makes a man so absolutely uninteresting.
Right,
ma'am. Well, they always want to be a woman's first love. That's their clumsy vanity. We women have a more subtle instinct about things. We like to be a man's last romance.
I see what you mean.
It's very, very beautiful. My dear child, you don't mean to tell me that you won't forgive your husband because he has never loved anyone else. Have you ever heard such a thing, Caroline? I am quite surprised.
Oh, women have become so highly educated, Jane, that nowadays nothing should surprise us except happy marriages. They are apparently becoming remarkably rare.
No, they're quite out of date.
Except among the middle class. As I have been told.
How like the middle classes?
Yes. Is it not very, very like them?
If what you tell us about the middle classes is true, Lady Stutfield, it redounds greatly to their credit. It is much to be regretted that in our rank of life, the wife should be so persistently frivolous under the impression that it is the right thing to be. It is to that I attribute the unhappiness of so many marriages we all know of in society.
Do you know, Lady Caroline,
I don't think the frivolity of the wife has anything to do with it. More marriages are ruined nowadays by the common sense of the husband than by anything else. How can a woman be expected to be happy with a man who insists on treating her as if she were a perfectly rational being?
My dear.
Man. Poor, awkward, reliable, necessary man. Belongs to a sex that's been rational for millions and millions of years. He can't help himself. It's in his race. The history of the woman is very different. We have always been picturesque protests among the mere existence of common sense. We saw its dangers from the first.
Yes, the common sense of husbands is certainly most, most trying. Please tell us your conception of the ideal husband. I think it'd be so very, very helpful.
The ideal husband! There couldn't be such a thing. The institution is wrong.
Together. That's all I've been trying to do ever since I came here.
You shouldn't threaten me, John.
I beg your pardon.
I'm just saying. I've walked all the way from school with these two, with him crying and with her being weird. And I walk in here and I've got you threatening me. You shouldn't threaten me, John. You really shouldn't.
Or what?
What?
You know, I'm interested. Or what?
Well,
he's just saying, John.
Shut up, Danny.
You shut up.
Don't tell Kathy to shut up.
I'm not telling her.
He's on Richard's side.
I'm not. Are you, Danny? Are you on Richard's side?
No.
He is.
What do you mean by my side? There is.
Have you got a side
now? I didn't say that.
Is that what you've got? Because if you got a side, that means you're not on my side. And if you're not on my side, that means you're setting yourself up against me. I thought we got over all that.
We have.
I thought we were mates.
We are mates now.
Good. So, if me and Richard are mates now, which we are, and you're on someone's side, Danny, you're on your own side.
No,
you... So are you on my side, then?
Yes, John.
Which means
I want to keep calm, I want to say nothing. Just like you, you're right, John.
I'm right. So what are you on about, Kathy? Are you on my side with Richard and Danny? Are you on our side?
Yes.
Great.
Lou!
Yes, John. You're on my side, Lou.
Yes, John.
Good.
That just leaves you. Brian. You pathetic, crying little piece of filth. I mean, come on.
I think we should tell someone.
Shut up, Brian. You know what? I am under a lot of stress. You lot should have put me under so much bloody stress.
Can I just say, John, that we haven't done anything? First of all, I want to say that if we have done anything, then we did it together. Whatever we did it together, if that's what you're thinking. If you're thinking that he did it on his own without me, well, you're wrong.
Have you told them yet?
No.
Brilliant. Is there one thing I don't have to do?
So, you want us to tell them?
Yes. Please?
It's Adam.
We're having a laugh. You know what Adam's like. So we're sort of, alright, taking the mix, sort of. You know what he's like. He's just hanging around.
And like, trying to be part of.
Yeah, trying to be part of. So, we're having a laugh.
With him?
Yeah, with him. I mean, he's laughing too. Like, so we decided to see how far we've gone. We got to eat some leaves.
Leaves? Yeah, like great big ones, dirty leaves off the floor. He ate them, just like that.
Just like that, we're all...
We were on stitches, weren't we? Adam too.
Adam was. He was laughing harder than anyone.
Nutter.
Complete nutter.
He even burnt his own socks.
Yeah, that's right. He set them alight.
Anything he'd do, just a laugh.
I got him to drink some vodka.
Oh my god, he was so scared.
You could tell he was terrified. He was completely. But he was like, pretending he's done it before, you know, big man.
You know what he's like, he'd
do anything. And you're thinking, will he do anything? What won't he do?
Let's punch him.
He was laughing.
At first.
Yeah, first. I mean, we took a bit far, right?
I mean, he was still joking all the way, but...
You could tell.
He weren't really, well...
You don't want to admit it, Phil. You know what he's like.
Oh, like we stubbed out cigarettes on him.
Joking. We were joking, really. Just having a laugh.
And crying, so to speak.
Or crying, sort of. A bit of both.
We also made him run across the road.
And you're thinking, what is this idiot? And with the vodka making you feel a bit, you know, you're having a laugh. What is this idiot gonna do next?
That's when I went home.
Only because you had to.
I wasn't there.
Only because you had to. You would have been there otherwise. You did everything.
catching those. Snow? Bloody forecast. Not cancel out in this jumper, I can tell you. Shoulder. Got no skin from here to here. Not a blade of grass in that bloody pitch.
Aye.
Watered pitch we had last week. Froze over 10 minutes after. Took a run at the ball. Took off. Must have travelled 20 bloody yards without lifting a finger.
Aye.
Ice. Be better off with a pair of skates. If there's a young woman who comes asking for me afterwards, they tell her to wait in the office. She'll be frozen to death out there.
Aye.
Aye, Christ.
Comes from Russia.
What?
Coal. Comes from Russia.
Oh.
Read a book. They had a special machine. Blew these winds over, you see. Specially freezing. Mixed it with a chemical. Froze the entire country. Then Ireland. Then crossed over to America and froze it out. Then, when everything was frozen, they came over in a special boot and took over. Here, America, nobody twigged it. Nobody cutting on, you see.
Oh, you think that's what's happening now, then?
Cold enough. Get no warning. Before you know what's happening, Rusky's here.
Couldn't be worse than this lot.
What?
Stopped 10 quid in bloody tax last week. I tell ya, I'm paying the government to keep me in work, mad ass. Bide my time over again. I'd emigrate. America, Australia.
Wherever you go, they'll find you out. Ruskies, keep your name down in the book. Won't make any difference if you go to socialist. Have you down there, up against the wall.
Who wants to read one or two bloody facts, old lad?
Facts? What facts? I read in one paper that in 25 years' time, not one country on earth will be communist. Don't worry, there'll be no lack in football then.
They like football in Russia as much as they like it here.
Aye.
Haven't you got a bloody coat hanger? Damn well that's for one each week.
Aye, don't worry. They'll bloody listen until they find it's well too late.
Fielding?
Patsy? Freeze your knuckles off today.
Ah, Christ.
I've no servants there, you know.
What's that?
No servants. Do your own carrying there.
What's that, Harry?
Russians. Going to be invaded.
Don't worry. Can happen any time, you know.
Going to freeze us with special liquid. Then come over. What was it? In special boots?
Get all those back, you know.
Back?
To Moscow. What do you say? He was reported back. Keep all names in a special book.
Keeping names in a special bloody book. Riley, first name Harry. Special qualifications can talk out of the back of his bloody head.
Don't you worry.
No, I'm not worried. They can come here any day of the week for me. Cup of ale.
10 flags.
That's all I need. I thought of ringing up this morning. Look that out the window. Frost. Got this house now. Just outside of the town. Wife's idea. Not mine. Bloody fields. Hardly a sign of human life. Cows, half a dozen sheep, goats, middle of bloody nowhere. If I can't see them all outside the window, I don't feel as though I'm living in the house. How's it look?
All right.
Bloody fist, loose throat, cropped in one before the end, had a leg like a melon. Get Lukey to put a bit of grease, should be all right. How's the shoulder?
All right, thanks.
Well, we live before, you know, everything you can want. Pit, boozer, dogs. As for now, trees, edges, miles of grass. Where's the jock straps, Harry? I thought of ringing up this morning, backing out, flu, some such like. By God, I'll have me lacking here, will you, Harry? When we bloody cobblers hanging out. Now, I'm only lad then. How's you keeping?
Shan't be a second. Hang on.
And you, Penny?
Not too bad. Here, see about my boot. Sod missed last Thursday. Supposed to check him every week. Come up to training, nearly tossed me ankle. God Christ, they only give good about art up here. Patter,
Kenny?
Bought one of them tool sets.
Tool sets? Got all the tools that I need, Kenny.
Spanner, screwdriver, hammer, just look.
What'd you do with that?
Take stones out of horses' hooves, more like.
Have you fixed it? Fixed and cleaned up that bog, Harry?
That lad's who's new this season. He'll tell you. One he had a four, I wouldn't have used.
Harry doesn't use a lad trick, do you?
Pals up behind the posts.
Dirty bugger.
Don't worry, it all goes down.
Goes down? Goes down where then, lad?
He's reporting it back to Moscow.
Moscow?
Some he does. Don't you bloody worry. Everything's there here.
Yeah, Harry, lad. You should have warned us.
Don't worry. Carry on. You'll be laughing the other side of your face.
Give him me number 4, Noel. And I'll be jumping up and down in the middle of your bloody backs.
By God, wouldn't mind me put on the bench today.
We had a good meal this evening. That's because we are English, and because we live in a suburb of London, and because our name is Smith.
Oh, no.
Cold ham is very nice with mashed potatoes. The mayonnaise was quite fresh. The mayonnaise from the grocer round the corner is better quality than the mayonnaise from the grocer opposite. It is even better quality than the mayonnaise from the grocer at the bottom of the hill. Of course, I don't mean to say that their mayonnaise is bad, yet the fact remains that the mayonnaise from the grocer around the corner is best. The fish was nice and fresh. It makes my mouth water just to think of it. I took 2 hen wings. No, 3. And it always gives me the collie wobbles. You took 3 hen wings too, but the third time, you took less than the first 2, and I took a lot more. I ate better than you this evening. How did that come about? You don't usually suffer from a lack of appetite. Our little boy would say he wants to drink some beer tonight. He'll be fond of a glass or 2 when he's older. Yogurt is very good for the stomach, lumbar regions, appendicitis, and apotheosis, at least according to Dr. Mackenzie King. You know, the one who looks after the Johns' children, people who live next door. He's a fine doctor. One can trust what he says. He never prescribes anything without testing it on himself first. Before he made Parker go through with that operation last year, he had himself operated on first, for liver, you know. Although, there was nothing wrong with him at the time.
Then how come the doctor came through it all right and poor old Parker died?
Why? Because the operation was successful on the doctor, and on Parker it wasn't.
In that case, then, Mackenzie's not a good doctor. Either the operation should have been successful on both of them, or both of them should have gone under.
What do you mean?
Well, if they can't both be cured, a real conscientious doctor ought to die with his patient. The captain goes down with his ship, he doesn't survive the wreck.
You can't compare a patient to a boat.
And why not? Even a boat has its little ailments. Besides, your doctor's a healthy enough vessel. All the more reason for him to perish with his patient, like the captain and his ship.
Ah, I hadn't thought of that before. Perhaps you're right. What do you make of it all, then?
It's very simple. All doctors are charlatans, and their patients too. The only respectable thing left in England is the Royal Navy.
But not sailors.
No, of course not. Well, according to this, Bobby Watson's dead.
Good heavens, poor fellow. When did it happen?
What are you looking so surprised about? You knew perfectly well he was dead. He died about 2 years ago. You remember, we went to the funeral about 18 months ago, it must be.
Of course, I remember perfectly. It came back to me at once. But I failed to understand why you had to look so surprised to see it in the paper.
It wasn't in the paper. It must have been 3 years since there was talk of his passing away. I was reminded of it by an association of ideas.
What a shame it was. He was so very well preserved.
He was the best looking corpse in Great Britain. Poor old Bobby. He'd been dead 4 years and he was still warm. A living corpse, if ever there was one. And how cheerful he always was.
Little Bobby, poor darling.
What do you mean, poor darling?
I'm talking about his wife, Bobby. As they shared the same name, you could never really tell them apart when you saw them together. It was only after he died that you could tell which was which. But fancy, even now, there are still people who mix her up with a dead husband when they offer their condolences. Did you know her, dear?
I only saw her once, quite by chance, at Bobby's funeral.
I've never seen her before. Is she nice looking?
She has regular features, but you can't call her beautiful. She's too tall and too well built. Her features are rather irregular, but everyone calls her beautiful. She's a little too short or too slight, perhaps. She teaches singing.
And when are they thinking of getting married? The two of them?
Next spring at the latest.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much indeed for your patience. As ever, it's been a very, very difficult job, but we're back here. Just before I leave the stage and leave you, the people of Miss Bradford, can I say an enormous thank you to all the performers who don't get a bow, so can you please applaud them all now, please? Can I say an enormous thank you as well, please, to Mr. Tom Barfield, Mr. Tom Jude, Mr. Jamie Coxon, and to Mrs. Claire Whitfield. It's amazing to have you back.
Mr. Norton's thanks, really. First of all, what a wonderful, wonderful display. You've made my job so very difficult. It's been a wonderful evening, and there was so much integrity in all your performances and the way you just held yourself tonight, and the commitment and the focus that you showed. So thank you very much for that. So what I'm going to do is go through each of the houses, just give you a little bit of a flavour of the things that I saw and that I enjoyed. And then we'll come on to the thing you're waiting for, which is the actual awards. So Thomas Cook's house, you maintained energy throughout your performance. I was really impressed with your comic timing. You showed understanding of pause and a good sense of ensemble, like a fantastic sense of ensemble. What a start we had. And some really good energy, beautiful delivery, and there was a sense of different characters really coming alive in that piece. So I thoroughly enjoyed that piece. It was really, really good. Well done. Really well done. What an opening piece for us. Moving swiftly on to Elmshurst. I loved this piece in terms of the use of vocal skills. Jack and it's Brian, wasn't it? Jack and Brian, your kind of almost comedy duologue going on there was really lovely. You had the straight man and the funny man in that piece, which was great. A lovely contained performance from Brian, allowing Jack to be really, really embellish what we were seeing, that comedy moment, those comedy moments. Great use of voice, phrasing and emphasis, and the energy, which could have very easily fallen flat, actually was kept really lively throughout. So very well done. And I know that Jack, you directed that as well, so kudos to you, well done. Ottilie Hill, Shakers. Fantastic sense of ensemble from Shakers, great timing, some lovely moments when you came forward and spoke with the audience. And what I got from Ottilie Hill was a really lovely sense of teamwork. There's that dialogue that's really quick, and you managed to nail it. It's very difficult, but you nailed it, so well done. And I felt like you kept each other going and you kept the momentum. It was a fast, furious play, but you kept that you kept that clear as well, clear voiced. So really well done for your ensemble piece there. Wendren Gordon. Some lovely theatrical pictures. We often talk in pictures in theatre, like can you kind of freeze it and see some lovely moments happening? And I think with Wendren Gordon, you created a real sense of theatre pictures, a lovely ensemble with the players, really funny, and very much enjoyed the rather naughty humour, and the audience interaction as well, like you really played up to the audience, as players should, so lovely there, and I felt like that was really fun full of energy and full of fun. So thoughtful as well. So really well done, guys. That was very, very nice indeed. Hazel Dean. Oh, that looked beautiful, didn't it? The opening of that was just exquisite. Again, that idea of theatre pictures, you know, creating a tableau. A lovely sense of energy, some really lovely moments and good interaction between the six of you. Sorry, Hannah, you're back. I really enjoyed the kind of relationships between the women in that. And I felt like there was precision in the execution of the dialogue. So it's difficult, you know, Wild is difficult. So getting that to be really clear for us was you know, really good. Well done for that. Moving swiftly on, Oakley. So you opened with such energy, quite scary, you know, straight away, the dead thing. Darkly humorous. Kelly is darkly humorous, and you really nailed that. Well done. It's really good. There's some lovely comic moments, despite the, what it was about. And Carissa, I thought that there was you managed to orchestrate that really nicely, but your ensemble around you was really strong. There was a real ensemble piece to that. You were always dynamic, and there was a sense of, again, working together as a team. So incredibly expressive as well. So well done. Really, really lovely. A difficult piece because it can be, again, the dialogue can be quite difficult to maintain. It's very, very conversational as we all talk, which sometimes is difficult on stage, but I felt like you did that really well. Walters, in the changing room, you northerners, I felt like you kept your accents up, you know. I know that, and some of you aren't from the north, right? But you maintain the accent, and there was lovely, lovely timing and a fab sense of character. And I felt like we always knew where you were, so a sense of location was really clear in this piece. A bit like with Ottilie's piece. The crossover dialogue, that dialogue is really difficult sometimes. You're always like trying to remember who you're talking to. And I felt like you did that really well. That was very professionally done. Very supportive of each other and some really lovely moments. So fabulous work from Walters. Well done. Mary Windsor. Gosh, that was like the mood was set immediately. Yeah, it was really professional and a very, very nice sense of fear and anticipation of what was going to happen next, and some really frightening physicality from the group there. I thought that was quite, you know, particularly believable in its the way it frightened me. You know, you've got a sense of what was happening and what was going on. Lovely relationships I've put here, and intense, very intense. Loved it. Okay, Schoolhouse. Oh, lovely. Neil, where are you? Oh, that was fab. You know, it's really difficult when an actor suddenly can't make something and you have to work with a stand-in, like Jen. Okay, but there was some lovely stillness, I think you'd all agree. We had some really bustling, energetic pieces, but then what you saw was how wonderful stillness can be as well. And I feel like, Neil, you did really well in that. There was a very particular precision about everything you did. Wonderfully contained. And I saw your enigmatic Mona Lisa smile come through, and I just wanted more of that. I felt like I really could see more of what you were doing. So again, to Schoolhouse, very, very well done. So that's the nine, yes?
That's my roundup. Could I ask the headmaster possibly to come on stage to make a presentation for us, please? Thank you very much.
Okay, so the Mary, you didn't want me to waffle on anymore, did you? No, you just want me to get on with it now. Okay, so as I mentioned, some lovely, lovely performances this evening. It has been, and I'm not just saying this, it has been incredibly, incredibly difficult to award this. but the Best Actor Runner-Up Award goes to Neil Abraham. The Special Adjudicators Award, now this was so, so difficult, but I finally plumped for their use of ensemble and their relationship with the audience. I just felt tipped with balance. They had these lovely theatre pictures, and so the Special Adjudicators Award goes to Wendron Gordon. So the best play is awarded to Mary Winslet.
Just a couple of things. Most importantly is to remind you that next Tuesday and Thursday in the theatre we have the Year 7 and 8 play, which is called There's a Leak. I can't really tell you very much more about it, but I know it's not going to be leaky, it's going to be fantastic. And then we have, coming up on the 18th of March, the two house music competitions, and then on March the 25th we have the senior house drama competition. I look forward to seeing you all there. And our splendid competitor, Jack, who did a fantastic job, has just got a couple of words to say. Thank you, Jack.
Thanks, sir. So this has been my first house drama competition at Brunswick School, and it's been a wonderful experience. I've really enjoyed being a part of this event. I'd like to apologise to anyone offended by my attempt at Northern Ireland. It gives me great pleasure to represent all the cast of this year's junior house drama competition. We would like to thank some people behind the scenes who have made this evening's performances possible. Firstly, to Mrs. Whitfield,
who has provided brilliant costumes while injured and over Zoom. Next to Mr. Poxton and Mr. Jude, the theatre technical team, who have helped to bring our scenes to life. We would also like to thank the sick formers, who have really created team spirit within the houses. And of course, we need to thank Mr. Norton and Mr. Barfield for the time, patience, encouragement and organisation during rehearsals and performance. Last, but certainly not least, to Miss Bradford for the difficult task of choosing tonight's winners. We have a little gift for you.
Thank you.